So this episode of Simulated Reality Podcast, we have Ashish Anantharaman, co-founder and CTO of ZestMoney, you know, one of the fastest growing consumer lending startups, not just in India, but across the world. Hi, Ashish. Welcome to Simulated Reality. So tell us about yourself, you know, how you got into this space, you know, consumer lending, you know, the highly competitive fintech space in India, which is really, you know, optimistic for the country. So tell us about your journey so far.
Hey, pleasure. Thanks for getting me here today. So probably to answer that question, I need to tell you a bit of a story. Story of my, you know, my career, because it is all shaped up in a way which has then led me to do what I'm currently doing, and hence the ZestMoney history story as well. So probably I'll just introduce myself, a bit of my background, how do I got into tech and then into the fintech space. So I was born and brought up in Bombay, did my education in Bombay, finished my degree, software engineering. Then I spent around 6 months doing animations, did some animations for some corporates at that time in India. Spent 6 months there doing animations, and then I moved out of India. Most of my time, like in all, I've got around 24 years of experience within the tech space. I spent 19 years of my time in the UK, working across several domains in the UK. Started off working as consultant in the top insurance companies, hardcore technical architecture role, which I did. Then spent 10 years in online sports betting industry, which is like online, which is high volume, high transaction. I love sports, passionate about technology. For me, that was a great domain to be in. Took a lot of push to get me out of that domain. And the next domain which I joined is the fintech, right? It took a lot of convincing. It took a lot of time and effort from the co-founder of the company in the UK, who started this fintech company, to move me from the betting space to fintech. Glad I took that decision, made that decision to switch. So that's how it all started, right? And once I got into the depth of fintech, no looking back. So I worked in a company in the UK, which was one of the top and the first and the most successful fintech company in the world. The way investors looked at fintech post that company completely changed everything. So for me, that was the first look at fintech. And the most important thing which I enjoyed is the impact that fintech brings into to the normal lives. The products that I was like heading engineering in that company, and which means I was very much very close with the end consumers. I knew how impactful the product that we were delivering was making impact in people's life. And at that point of time, the company was looking at moving into India. For some reason, that didn't happen. That is something which was very close to me because, again, coming from India, I thought that the product which we were like, which is what ZestMoney is all about right now, and because I could see the value it was adding to people's life, I always had it in me to kind of bring that product into India. But because the company was not able to start that expansion into India, that's when the three of us, the three co-founders, we decided to do it ourselves, right? So fintech has always been, I think, for a long period of time, it was the second option for me, after you know, the online sports betting. But then for the last 6 years now, I think it has already taken over the, to take a number one spot in terms of my preferred choice of my preferred domain. So that's how it all started. And I think the years of experience within technology, how do you use your technology skills along with the experience of fintech itself, which I have gathered in established markets, tightly regulated markets. I think the combination of those two is like so powerful, and that's what we said, okay, let's bring in all this experience into India, because here is a country which there is a need of similar kind of a product that ZestMoney is currently building. So there is a need, there's a great opportunity, and I think it's a timing as well, right? So when we started ZestMoney in 2015, a year prior to that was when India's initiative towards or look towards digital digitization of the country itself that completely changed. So for us, it was a timing as well.
Mm.
And I think it all just worked together and it came together at the right time.
So how different was it, you know, if you compare the online sports betting to this fintech space, which is obviously very serious because you're dealing with, you know, risk. There also, there is risk, but this is a different kind of risk and, you know, a lot of regulatory pressures and you have to make sure that there are no defaults and you have to be on top of data. So how different was the two things if you compare?
Okay, so probably before answering how different it is, let's talk about the common elements.
Yeah,
right?
Definitely.
So talking about data, so both the industries need data.
Yeah.
Right? That's massive. Without that, nothing is going to happen. That's one. Second, whenever we are talking about fintech, there is high volume which is linked to it. Along with the volume, it's the transaction size as well, right? So everything is related in terms of, let's say, being in the online sports betting or within the fintech space. So these are the three common elements. The fourth one, I would say, is probably this is where the difference is. The online sports betting is about, you know, the experience that you give the customers, but that is all for an entertainment.
Hmm.
The value changes completely when it comes to the fintech space. User experience need to be retained, but the impact it causes in people's life. So it's not about entertainment anymore.
Yeah.
It's about existence. It's about survival. It's about dream and how it's about upgrading their lives and so on and so forth. So the intent and the purpose is completely different. So I would say between both these industries, I mean, look, technology is an enabler, right? And it doesn't matter whether you're using it for online sports betting industry or in a fintech space. So technology has its role to play. But then how do you use the technology to address it for enhancing the user experience for entertainment or for a social impact in the positive way is where the difference lies.
Sure. Sure. So then how did you meet the two other founders? You know, how did it all come together when you decided on a product which was going to make an impact? And as well as, you know, you have to make sure that you receive the funding, that you scale. I mean, there are a lot of things. So how did it all begin from there, from sports betting?
So, yeah. So when I joined the other company, the fintech company in the UK.
What was the name?
The company's name is Wonga.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So my two co-founders, Lizzie and Priya, they were already working at Wonga. They joined. So Lizzie was hired to expand the Wonga business into India. Priya was handling the corporate strategy at that point of time. I was brought in to re-architect the whole engineering platform across all the five regions of Wonga and the three products that they were building. But the common factor which got us all together, three of us together, was again the plan of the expansion into India, right? We were all working towards a common goal. And for some reason, the company decided not to continue with their plans to expand into India. And because we were already connected and three of us were connected and we spent a lot of time dreaming about India or bringing this product into India, around 9 to 12 months, once the decision was made by the company, by Wonga, not to move to India, there was a message that came from Lizzie to two of us saying that, hey, how are you guys up for doing our own stuff? And without a blink, we said, yes, we'll do it, right? So we were all waiting for an opportunity as to who is going to take the first step to make it happen. And the first instance of when an opportunity arrived, when Lizzie, you know, sent us that message, we were like, all right, let's do it together. Because it's the balance that the three of us bring in. It's the years of experience that the three of us hold within fintech, number one, and overall experience as well, I think. And the way the dynamics the three of us have in terms of understanding and working together and producing results and at the same time building a great company. I think we said, you know, I think the chemistry is great. So let's go ahead with it. And that's how we decided to start ZestMoney.
Today, you know, there's so many startups who are like working in fintech, you know, it's kind of like this extreme hype that is in this space. Do you think that you got into the space early enough so that you're not, you know, inundated by this hype, wave of hype? you made the right decisions at the right time before, you know, so that way you got like a first mover advantage for consumer lending, kind of?
Absolutely. I think timing is very important.
Mm.
If we had started this in 2011, I would say, again, the timing would have caused a big impact because India was not ready. The people were not ready about, you know, we would have had to spend a lot of time educating the users about digital India, educating them about the digital money, the process, and so on and so forth. And along the same time, Flipkart had come in and made such a big wave in the e-commerce space. Amazon, of course, the known brand, moving from outside India, moved into India. Paytm, they came into play. So they had already done the homework. They had done the groundwork of enabling the people on what this digital revolution is all about. Hence, the time when we started, I think we couldn't have timed it better because of whatever I had said that had already happened, number one. Number two, investors got more serious about India. Number three, the opportunity of consumer lending grew. Number four, our regulators in the form of RBI had better control and planning and strategy about how the space of consumer lending needs to be regulated, which means things were no longer in gray in terms of any directions that is going to come out from them. How the system, how the product and the platform need to be compliant, even details and clarity of those were emerging. So I think all in all, the timing was like impeccable. You're right? It's such a, fintech is such a buzzword, at least it has been for the last couple of years, whereby anybody who wants to do a startup, the first thing that would come to their mind is, let's do fintech. Let's go the fintech way. Not a bad option at all, because at the end of the day, I think, you know, why fintech existed? Why did it even come to the fore? It's because of the way the banks have been doing whatever they have been doing for the last, you know, hundreds of years. But then it was not catering for what the new age consumers are looking for. In all of the space, technology was enabling the speed and the experience of the users, but in fintech it came a bit too late. So I think, again, it's all about the timing, right? It happened in other parts of the world, and then India was like waiting for somebody to make a start.
Mm.
And I think, you know, Bajaj were already over here, but they were like doing completely offline.
Yeah.
The online space was completely open, and hence that opportunity to kind of bring this product into India was so important, and I'm just repeating myself. Yeah, the timing couldn't have got better.
And not just the timing. Do you think that the demonetization part was a, you know, biggest precipitator, the catalyst that, you know, pushed everything towards fintech, you know, and digital money? Do you think that also maybe, you know, played a role in people accepting digital money? I mean, we saw what happened with Paytm right after demonetization. So, do you think there's, you know, just kind of snowball effect that happened from there?
Absolutely. So anything, whatever that happened after 2014, I think that paved its way to where we are as a company, as a nation today, right? So be it demonetization or be it the whole digital revolution, I think 2014 onwards it all started. And then we were like, of course, nobody anticipated that was going to happen. But I would definitely say it was a big push in the direction of how digital money was being exchanged within India. So probably data kind of, you know, it tells us everything. Week one after demonetization, the amount of transactions that was happening skyrocketed, and it didn't stop from there, right? Because then some of the experts said that, you know, once the circulation of cash is going to be back into the country, then probably that wave would settle down. But that didn't happen. It just continued. And that's the beauty of it.
Yeah.
Because this is where the customers, they understood the power of, you know, be it online banking or digital transfer of monies or whatever it is, right? So they could see, they could realize how useful, how the experience is. Like, no, you don't have to go back to a bank or stand in that queue to withdraw cash to pay someone else. Just double two clicks and you're done. So I think everything post 2014 kind of enabled the way India looks at digital money, and the experience completely transformed. And lending is probably another feather to the cap, I would say, because it just, the credit engine which gets attached to the the digital wallet, which was like existing as a part of the whole Paytm initiative. And I think it worked beautifully for us.
Yeah. And kind of like the moment was so like precise. I mean, Jio happened, the India stack, Aadhaar, everything, you know, KYC thing. So everything just came together for a smooth process. But do you think like currently like there's too much hype probably, because you would know better because you've been in online betting as well. You would know the human hype and all. So do you think now, right now, probably it's overextended and there are like too many players who are not creating as much value?
So... look, whenever a domain is hot, you can expect more players to come into that, right? Now, there's a good thing and a bad thing that can happen with that. Too many players, too many wrong players can come and pollute the market in such a way that the whole domain itself gets a bad name. The whole practices and the ethics that they follow, probably that is going to hurt a domain for a long time. That could definitely happen. But we being the first one into this space, we made sure that we are part of a body which keeps a check on how things and how this domain needs to operate, right? So my co-founder and CEO, Lizzie, she's part of this group, DLAI, Digital Lending Association of India, and she is like an active member of that body, which keeps an eye and who are like in constant touch with the regulators, with the RBI, to make sure that, you know, whatever that gets done into the lending space are in line with what the RBI are expecting. So it's building in that kind of a kind of a rule book so that any new player coming in, it would act as a kind of a guideline for them to follow those steps and make sure that they don't come and spoil the market and hence impact the customers. So I think, hype exists, but I think it's all about how do you control it. And then what we decided as a company is we will not leave that control to someone else. Let's be part of that control. Let's take that control. Let's showcase how this needs to be done. And again, this comes down from the experience that the three of us hold working outside India in a very regulated market. And we clearly know what are the things that you should not be doing whenever you're talking about this space. So hence, I think... It's okay. It's okay for many such players to come in because at the end of the day, the consumer, they need options. It also going to help us get better. We need competition as well. And I think it's all about the product. And it's all about what kind of process that you follow. And if you don't get these two things right, and of course, if you don't put customers first, again, these three things, the product is not going to survive. So many players come in, they miss one of the three, what I just listed, what I just mentioned now, and they have to shut down, right? So from 2015 onwards, right, it's not that this hype started only now or a year back. In 2016, once we launched in 2015, 2016, we had around 13 players in this space doing exactly what we were doing. But then mid-2017, none of them existed, right? Again, from 13 other companies doing what ZestMoney did, only three existed, right? Now, from 2017 to 2018, just two existed. So it's all about the survival game. If you can build a product which is of great use to the consumers, and if you put customers first and you take care of them, I think... whereby their experience is like kind of enhanced every single day. I think that's the mantra for success for any companies within fintech. So that is something which I would kind of advise the younger startups of India who are into fintech especially.
Yeah, but you know, although there were like so many good things that happened, not everything was rosy. I mean, the NBFC crisis happened, you know, and obviously it overextended. So what impact do you think the NBFC crisis had on ZestMoney itself or like the other fintech startups that have been doing great so far? How is the market doing right now because of that thing?
Liquidity crisis can hit us at any point of time, right? When it happened back in August, September last year, we didn't knew that it was coming.
Mm.
People were like all talking about the economic downturn globally and how it was going to impact India. India was still growing at 5.4% at that point of time, but still people were a bit nervous. Then RBI, they issued a notice about, you know, how bureau data can be accessed and a couple of other regulations which they came up with. That triggered that nervousness further, and it led to this liquidity crisis where the NBFCs and the banks, they just wanted to hold on to their monies and not lend it at all, not give it away, because thinking that the economic downturn is happening, is just around the corner, so let's kind of save this money. Most of our competitors, they kind of stopped operations. Now, ZestMoney, on the other hand, grew at the same time. Now, why did that happen? Is because of the model that we followed, right? We didn't want to rely on, let's say, one NBFC. We wanted to, our strategy has been to build this kind of a marketplace where it can be multiple NBFCs on the platform, which would act as the credit engine for, giving out loans to our consumers. So that, along with a couple of other key strategies from our side, is what kind of helped ZestMoney grow during a time of a crisis when others or with all other competition kind of slowed down or kind of even paused their operations till they got their act together. Same is the case with KYC as well, right? So, see, it's about taking that responsibility. We look at ourselves as the main player within the space within India, as of now. So when KYC hit us with the regulations and everything, within a span of a couple of days, we were able to provide multiple other channels of getting the KYC done and also passed on some recommendations to RBI on how else can we do the KYC process, doing it digitally, number one, and making it easy for the customers to get it done as well, so that the turnaround time and the experience of the customers are like not impacted. Because the last thing that you would want is, you know, go back to the paperwork of what we used to do 25 years back. We should be doing things as a company. Again, this is what technology is all about, right? You bring in the technology so that it would enhance or enhance the customer's experience. If you're going to ask them to take a printout, sign, scan, upload, it's going to take some effort. And if you look at the millennials, they don't want to spend time doing all those things. Just they want to click, a couple of clicks that too, get the job done. Be it making a purchase, be it getting money, borrowing money, or whatever is the case, right? So when it came to KYC, we came up with some a brilliant platform-related product which gives an option of different kind of flavors that we offer to the customers and, of course, to the lenders as well, that these are the different ways the KYC can be done. Just last month, RBI approved one such KYC channel that we proposed, and it is in play. So probably in few weeks' time, you will see that kind of a KYC, which is the video KYC I'm talking about, which would get into play, and it would just, again, enhance customers' experience.
So how does that work with the video KYC, if you can touch upon that?
Sure. So it's about there will be an agent sitting on one side of the world of India, and let's say you are a customer somewhere in Hyderabad.
Mm.
A call would be initiated, right? So it's about digitizing or bringing the whole KYC, offline KYC experience online. In the offline world, you need to take an appointment for KYC. Let's say if you have to go to get your KYC done for your Paytm account, wallet, you need to say that, hey, this is the time when somebody would visit you, or you might have to just go down to one of the shops who are like KYC approved shop of Paytm. You have to take your documents to them. They will look at the documents, they'll look at you, probably ask you some more questions, and then they'll take a photo of that, photo of you as well, and then they would just attest it and send it, upload it to the PTM system, right? It's about mimicking whatever the offline process is onto the online world, which means one of our agent will be on our side. There'll be an appointment which the customer needs to take in, and then it'll happen as a part of the process itself, loan application process. Once the appointment date and time is confirmed, there will be a call which will be made to that customer, a video call, and the agent is going to introduce himself or herself to that customer, and they're going to ask them to hold the identifications so that it can be read by the system. And it also takes, and also the agent will ask the customer to sit in a particular way so that a photograph can be taken as well. So everything that happens in the offline world happens in the online world. It is just about getting it done on the comfort of your living room or your bedroom, as simple as that. So that's how it works. And then the whole session is like recorded, and then the data is like stored somewhere in one of the repositories so that at the time of an audit, you can pull that for that customer who is being audited in terms of the data. And you'll have all the information that this is an evidence that the KYC for this customer has been done. This is the timestamp of when it was done. And these are the documents which the customer produced. And there you go.
But, you know, KYC is like a double-edged sword for most companies, you know, especially if they are not able to secure the data, right? So what do you think can be done better? I mean, video KYC is great, obviously. Mm-hmm. And the fact that ZestMoney proposed it and got accepted is great. But then what can be done better to, you know, to ensure not just the regulators, but the users as well, that their data is secured completely, you know, especially in the age of quantum computing and, you know, cyber attacks constantly happening?
So again, this is where the data privacy needs to be taken very seriously, number one. Number two, regulations on around how data needs to be stored, that needs to be taken seriously as well. Number three, there has to be a frequent checks on how your data can be accessed from your system. That also needs to be looked at, right? So in terms of data privacy, again, there are some strict guidelines on what kind of data that can be shared, to whom it can be shared, how it needs to be shared, when it can be shared, and so on and so forth. So as a company, it is their responsibility to make sure that these guidelines are being followed. So that is the data privacy guidelines. Second is about how data can be accessed, number one, or it can be stored. So again, there are some rules around how it can be stored, that the data needs to be encrypted. There has to be, if you're storing some credit card details or card details, it needs to be done some cold storage. Who have got very limited access, who needs to have access to it, how they access it, when do they access it, from where do they access it. So all these questions needs to be answered. And then there is a frequent audit that needs to happen to make sure that these policies are being adhered to. And if there is any kind of a breach, then it needs to be like flagged up. So it comes down to the responsibility of the organization that it needs to make sure that frequent checks are being done. Especially when it comes to money, it's very important that certain certification needs to be obtained. So an ISO certification is a standard certification which talks about, you know, or it confirms how an organization has taken security seriously, be it a bank, be it an NBFC, be it a platform. Anybody going through that certification process would enable them, or it will assist them to kind of validate how they have been operating. Because it's just not about how data can be accessed from an online system. It is also about, you know, who is walking into your office at what point of time, which part of the day they are walking into the office. So there are a lot of aspects around security, which is very important. And unfortunately in India, security is something which is not given the importance that it should be.
Yeah, I mean, and a lot of government websites, if you look at, they're not even like encrypted. I watch it constantly. And I mean, that's like a little scary.
It is, but again, for anything related to, you know, customer data. So there has been a lot of rumors that goes on. Like I think a couple of years back, there were news around how, what is that? Around 200 million Aadhaar accounts,
yes,
were being sold,
yes,
to some other company or something along
for
those
lines. For 1,000 rupees.
For 1,000 rupees, exactly, yeah. Right? So some part of it is scary because you just can't afford a central database
yes.
to be available this easily for just 1,000 rupees, right? And it has happened. If it had happened, it has happened because of someone's negligence rather than anything else.
Hmm.
That is because, again, it's the company's responsibility or that body's responsibility to make sure that such breaches, you build some systems around it, some processes around it to make sure that such breaches shouldn't happen. Again, it is not limited only to India, right? So as you can, you would have read about how one of the UK companies, their card systems were like hacked. And it was hacked for close to 7 days. And they had to like shut down their operations for another 7 days to make sure that it patches up and it is all patched up. So it's a global problem. But in India, it gets amplified because of the negligence that we as a country adopt when it comes to security.
But do you think something like distributed computing or some cryptographic technology could help, for example, blockchain, where data is distributed across different nodes and then you can only access it, you know, with the consensus of different nodes, not in a centralized depository? Do you think that kind of a technology may be helpful in this scenario?
It's a great technology, but unfortunately, it is not a proven technology in a way where it can be used to that extent that way you're describing it, right? Because if there is, again, a single lapse, that's gone. Things will be like ruined within a matter of seconds. Because, see, I believe in one thing. Any technology needs some space and time to evolve itself to become the right choice of technology for building a solution, right? So blockchain has been around for the last 4 years.
Yeah.
When it started off with a bank. Every person, every kid, you know, every block wanted to do blockchain. They all started learning about blockchain. They started implementing or writing code for blockchain. But the problem is, there were no real use cases where blockchain could be implemented and taken into production and used it at scale. This is where technology kind of gets hit most of the time, whereby anything new comes in, the hype hits. And then it gets absorbed and it gets followed for a while. But then the most important thing over here is the use case. Once you don't have a use case for any of such technology, it dies, right? So with blockchain is the same thing. So distributed computing is definitely an option which it can be kind of experimented with. But when it comes to money, and especially in this world of money laundering and all those things, it needs to be like very tightly regulated. So every country are taking this a bit too carefully.
Yeah.
They're taking it very
slowly. A country like Singapore, example, they have embraced it, not just enterprise blockchain, but public blockchains like Ethereum and even cryptocurrency. They have like completely embraced it, and it's like the fintech hub of the world. So do you think there is something that we can learn or probably see, you know, proof of concepts there?
So if you look at the size of Singapore, the volume that they do, and the size of India, so it's massive difference, right?
Yeah.
The scale itself is like completely, you can't match them. Look, I'm open to experimentations, right? What you should be doing is you try out something as a subset of something big, but it has to be a subset. Give it some time, improve the quality of it. And then over the period of time, once you're comfortable that this is like hacker-proof, no ambiguity when it comes to the process or anything.
Yeah.
It ticks all the boxes from a compliance regulatory point of view. And then the technology is good enough to be supported for the next, let's say, 10 more years, then take it to the next level. So it's all about starting slow and experimenting with it. Singapore spent a lot of time doing it. In fact, for the last 5 years, they have been doing it. But again, they started it the same way. No one would take a big bang approach. But again, it's all about scale. India being such a massive country, it'll be difficult for us to manage it. So just think about it, right? When demonetization happened, how it hit the country, the problems or the issues that people faced 3 months after demonetization continue to happen for a long time, right? The impacts were like quite profound. So India, it's going to be a bit difficult, but I think at the same time, we should be open to such experiments, and we should be definitely are trying out more things when it comes to using of technology.
But do you think that the speed at which technology is moving currently, especially in the fintech space, is matching up with the regulatory efforts? Because I feel sometimes, you know, the regulators are a bit slow, you know, in comparison to what the innovation that is happening. So how can that be matched? Should there be like special bodies, committees that are working with startups closely and not just, you know, from somewhere far away?
So again, this is not an India problem. It's a global issue, right? Any regulators, they take a very conservative approach when it comes to managing risk, right? They want to make sure that anything that is proven, anything that has been existed, and any process that has evolved over a long period of time should be the right way of taking things forward as well. Technology, yes, it enhances the experience for the consumers. At the end of the day, the regulators also want to keep an eye on that their process should not be so tight that at the end of the day, it impacts the customer experience as well. So they are aware of it, but they are very conservative in their approach. So this is where the responsibility of the fintech companies comes into play. It's not about just, you know, building this great user experience for the consumers. It's about balancing the rest of the ecosystem as well. So for them, and hence, we have made sure that we spend a lot of our time speaking to RBI, advising them on certain technologies and, you know, how things can enhance, how things can speed up at their end as well. So at the end of the day, they won't have a team who are like looking at technology very closely. Probably that is not right. They might still have a team to do it, but then they're going to be like too cautious in their approach. I think it's about doing it, showing it, and inspire. That's what I believe in. So I think anything that we as a company do, I would say we would experiment it and then take it to the RBI, take it to the regulators and show them, hey, listen, this was a problem statement. This is what we have been following for a long time. This is how we can bring in technology to enhance the experience, be it from a regulatory side or even from a consumer side or from a overall transaction side. And let's see whether you guys would be happy to take it forward or do you want us to enhance it further? So it's about engaging with them on a regular basis till the time that they are comfortable that the options we are providing them with technology actually works, right? So I believe that we need to put in a lot of hard work to change the way regulators think and operate, but it is not impossible. I think it's part of something which we have taken upon ourselves to make sure that the technology has got its space within a regulated setup.
Yeah. I was watching Lizzie's, you know, video, TEDx video, and she was talking about the credit card model is actually broken and it's not fair for the people who don't have that high incomes. So do you think that in coming years, players like ZestMoney, you know, would actually have an upper hand compared to the traditional credit card business models?
Of course. I mean, look, I look at credit card as a 70-year-old technology. Right? It's 70. Yeah, that's a time when I think 70 years back
is
when, exactly. So every technology has its space, has its age rather. And then after a point of time, it gets a bit stale unless you bring in some innovation. But look at a card. What else can you innovate with a card? So the other day when I was, when I flew in from Bombay to Bangalore, I saw an ad of a card. I forget the name of the bank. I think SBI, if I'm not wrong. Sorry, probably not. Where they were having some four buttons on a card, right? And okay, I mean, with all due respect, I don't know how much of an innovation you can have over there. And then American Express came up with this beautiful metallic card, right? A card is a card.
Yes.
It will do what it is supposed to do. It is not going to do anything beyond that. So for me, that's a very outdated technology. Whenever we interview our customers, right, I kind of speak to quite a few number of customers. And one question which I ask them is about, do you have a credit card? The answer to that would be, yes, I do. Some of them would say, no, I don't. For those who do hold a credit card, said, when do you use them? Or why do you use them? Well, I can use it so that I can get some privileges, lounge access when I'm traveling, right? So that is a standard statement. And there will be a very smart bunch of people who would say, I'm very clever in the way I'm managing my money. I just want to make sure that I don't pay interest. So that's the reason I use it. Here we have two sections who are defining two use cases of using a card. Rest would say, I have a card because I was given one, but it is lying in my, it's locked in my cupboard somewhere. I don't use it because I don't like the concept of credit card.
Mm.
But then why do you have it? When there is a need, I will take it out, but I don't want to use it at all, right? Let's bring in some data over here. How many credit cards are in circulation within India? Roughly 50 million.
Out of a population of
1.3 to 1.4 billion.
That's bizarre.
It's bizarre, right? So we have a slide which talks about the credit card penetration within India compared to other parts of the world. UK, it is 96%. China, it is close to 60%, or probably even higher. US, again, as high as UK. Australia, again, in the high 90s. India, 2.7%, right? Again, it's very similar to those who... See, how do you get a credit card, right? So when I moved back to India, and I was like banking with American Express for 20 years, when I moved to India, I requested for a credit card, right? I never got one. Lizzie got a credit card after 6 years. I got a credit card after 3 years, right? And every time I used to be chased for being given a credit card, I would like kind of say, sorry, I would be like told that you need to provide us with this documents. We'll have to wait for 7 days or 14 days, and then we will give you the credit card. But that credit card never arrived, right? So there is a lot of uncertainties around who can get a credit card, who cannot get a credit card. And then last year there was a drive that came up where you'll be able to, you know, avail EMI on a debit card. Now I said, okay, let's try out that as well. And then when I, without taking the merchant's name, I called up their customer service and asked them, hey, you said I can get an EMI on the debit card. I logged into the system. I did a transaction, but I don't see this option. Sir, you're not eligible for it. I'm like, okay, what do I need to be eligible for it? She listed out certain things. I said, okay, so these are the same eligibility criteria which is needed for a credit card as well. I said, same rules apply, sir. I'm like, thank you.
What's the point?
So what's the point? So it's about, you know, skinning the cat in different way, but the process, the underlying process is just the same, which is you need to tick certain boxes. Just 60 million of the population out of 1.4 billion, tick those boxes. What happens to the rest? This is where ZestMoney comes in. Especially for those who are like kickstarting their career, got onto a new job, or about to get married, or they've got married, want to move to a new house. Where are they going to get access to this credit from? Right? And if they don't have, a bureau score or a credit score, they are never going to be getting any kind of credit at all at any point of time. And the current system is working in such a way whereby you're not promoting the next 200 million into the top stream of consumers so that even they can be provided with a credit card or any kind of a credit facility, right? There is no such process. This is where ZestMoney comes in, whereby along with the tick boxes which I was talking about, it provides or it has taken the initiative or the drive to move the next 200 million from the 50th million to the 300 million customers into the top category so that they can be availed. Because we fundamentally believe that getting access to credit, everybody should have access to that credit. Whether you use it or not is up to that individual, right? It's their decision. But it's like, are you eligible to vote? As an Indian, you should be eligible to vote as long as you are ticking off certain criteria. Same is the case with credit as well. If you are eligible, you should be getting it. You should have access to that credit. It comes into the individual whether they consume it or not.
So what is ZestMoney strategy then? You know, what kind of models or algorithms does ZestMoney have that it is able to provide EMIs and loans to people without a credit card? So if you can talk about that.
Sure. I mean, look, there are a lot of things that goes into our engine before making a decision whether to lend money to an individual or not. lots of checks around affordability comes in, a lot of fraud related checks that comes into play, their transaction history that comes into play. So we have got around 8,000 data points which we use to make a decision whether to lend to a customer or not. And these data points, if you look at the onset of the whole process, a common man will not be able to even determine ki how much of such data points are ZestMoney collecting. But during the process, the user behavior gives us a lot of information as well. So along with the data that I'm talking about, which I mentioned about transactional data, the bureau data, the bank data, which are like, which is what, you know, most of the companies are or can could look at you consuming. But we look at those standard data, and the most powerful thing for us is the alternate data. And this is what, whether it is in the form of click stream, whether it is in the form of user behavior, user responses whilst they are on the user loan application journey, we bring in all these elements into play and then push that into our engine, and that engine would do magic because that's where our secret sauce is, right? And then we make sure that we make a right decision on that consumer. So it's no longer going to be, so when I applied for a Bajaj Finserv loan, right, around 10 months back, they rejected me. Of course, they're not going to give me any reason why I was rejected, but they rejected me. That too after
Know you're the this big guy who is like a co-founder this month.
Well, it's always good to be anonymous in terms when you're trying out certain products, right?
But if they had just Googled you, I'm sure they would have accepted.
See, if you're going to go to an... See, that's the offline model, right?
So why is that data not being considered? I mean, that's also valuable data, right?
See, there has to be a mechanism of translating or using or consuming. Any company who are like a technology-first company will understand the power of data, will identify data, will understand how to analyze that data and consume it in the way it makes more sense and it adds meaning to the decisions that you're going to make. So, unfortunately, if you are not a technology company, technology-driven company, you're not going to look at any piece of data as an important piece. Because why does this concept of big data and the data lakes come into play? It's about dumping all the data that you have into that space and try to make some sense out of the data. No data is a waste data, right? It all makes sense. It all depends upon how do you interpret it, how do you consume it, right? So this is where companies who are been following an offline model never managed to move out of that operating model into the online space. And why are the banks so slow, right? Because they have a process which is so rigid.
Again, 70 years old.
No, banks have been like 300 years old, yeah, right? Yeah. So it's about that process and how rigid those things are. And any new technology that you bring in, it's going to be difficult to kind of change that. As a company, from a ZestMoney kind of company, which is like four and a half years old, we adapt to changes very quickly. We embrace the newer technology that emerges out there. And we are cautious, yes, to make sure that it is the right technology. We do a lot of experiments and POCs to make sure that we make the decision whether to adopt that technology or not. But at the end of the day, we embrace changes. We are open to new open technologies, open source technologies, and we kind of continuously experiment with them. So this is where the difference lies between an offline way of operating business or even the banks compared to the likes of ZestMoney.
Yes. And what does your technology stack look like? You know, if we talk about front end, back end, the database, you know, the automation technologies, what does it look like all?
Sure. So let me bring in something very important, probably your users might have not looked at, and this is something which is emerging, and I'm kind of promoting this as much as I could, be it within India and even outside India. People are like obsessed with the cloud computing, with cloud technologies, right? And with AWS, again, the thought process is anything that you want to do, go to the cloud, do it over there. It leads to two things. Cost implications, because it's just available over there. Software engineers these days just consume it at will without worrying about the cost of the same, right? That's number one. Second thing is about the dependencies that you are bringing in when you're going to the cloud. So at ZestMoney, we are on the cloud, okay? There's a big difference what I'm saying over here. Most of the companies, 99.9% of the companies, anybody on Amazon or Azure, Google Cloud, are in the cloud. There's a big difference. When you are in a cloud, if the strategy is about being in the cloud, you're tied to the hip. Your company, your platform is tied to the hip with that technology, with the cloud provider, right? When you're on the cloud, you're detaching yourself from that connection and you're moving into a space so that you are, should you want to move away from that provider to a different provider or probably do your own in hosting, you're allowed to do it or you can do it. With someone like AWS, where you just blindly jump into their system, detaching yourself from AWS, so their cost is just going to keep on increasing every single month. Till the point you'll reach that, you know, you will understand that, oh my God, this is going beyond what I had budgeted for. And then if you're going to define your strategies or relook at your strategies and say, hey, now let's kind of move away from AWS, let's go to GCP, that's not going to work because you're in the cloud. So we as a company, we made sure that we are on the cloud, number one. In terms of the technology stack for the front end, we are like Angular. We our backend is because we are service oriented platform is what we have built. We have a combination of Python, Java, Node, Golang. Our database, like MySQL, we use DynamoDB as well. We are like completely on the cloud. So that is our technology stack look like.
Yeah, and you mentioned, you know, the data technologies. And so do you have like a data science team as well?
So we have a data science team. We have got a data engineering team. We have got a risk technology team.
Yeah.
We have, of course, a front-end team, a back-end team. We have an AI team. We have a DevOps setup.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's how our tech org or product engineering org looks like.
So in terms of AI, what is there any research that you're doing or is there any specific models that you have that you would like to talk about?
Absolutely. So I think, okay, when I was talking about the technology about blockchain, one thing which I mentioned to you was about use cases, right? And I've been on several panels on AI, be it the Fireside Chat hosted by AWS or a couple of other every month or something, I'm like with the AWS folks doing these talks on AI. So one thing which I talk a lot about is the use cases within AI and ZestMoney. And then I've been like talking to several such players within the space who have done AI, used AI in the right way. Because AI is such a technology where, you know, it's not necessary to use AI everywhere. You use it when it is at most needed and not just use it because it is because it's a buzzword. Unfortunately, that's the way that world is moving. And then you go so deep into that process that without identifying the use case, you start your development. And then unfortunately, the ROI for such implementation never crosses your zero mark, right? So hence, within at ZestMoney, we made sure that we identified those use cases. So we have done several such. So let me give you a couple of examples on why and how we have used AI over here, right? So let's talk about a process, a loan application journey. So you as a customer come into, you're applying for the loan. After you fill in all your details, we need to make a decision on you. We would make a decision. Once a decision is made, we need to link you up with the lender, right? Because at the end of the day, the lender is going to give you the money. So we as a platform are going to connect the consumer with the lender. Now, I mentioned to you that we have built this kind of a marketplace where we have multiple lenders on our platform, right? So as a customer is coming through a loan application journey, there has to be a way which needs to determine to which lender I need to move this consumer or this loan application to customer to. Two ways of doing it. I build one complex logic, and I continue to enhance that logic whenever a new lender joins, and say that if this condition, then, and if this condition, and this condition, and this condition, move it to lender one, or this condition, lender two. So what is happening over there is a very static logic, which needs to be amended whenever the parameters of moving a loan to a lender changes, right? So that's going to be like a lot of human intervention. There's going to be a lot of dev intervention, I must say, which comes into play when that such a thing happens. That is one way of solving the problem. The second way of doing it is bringing in AI, whereby you build your model in such a way where it can go and self-learn itself based on the data that it gets in. So we have built this model, and we call it as a routing engine, whereby based on the data of 3 months, we kind of train this model in such a way whereby it will automatically detect based on the parameters and that the consumer loan entity comes up when we are able to push it to the relevant lender. Now, where does the self-learning comes into play over here is, again, based on certain parameters and a new lender gets added, this model would self-train itself in a way that we don't need to get a developer to add in the parameter or make a change to that model. But the model will automatically train itself to adapt to those changes and push the loan application to the relevant lender. This is AI at its best in terms of the use case, because tomorrow we might have 100 lenders on our platform. Here is a platform, here is a system which has learned to train itself in such a way whereby anything new gets added to that engine will be automatically assigned, it will automatically get picked up and assigned, pushed it to the relevant lender. So that is one classic example of where we use AI within ZestMoney. I can talk about another example. Look, in lending, they say it's easy to give money and very hard to collect it back, right? So we use a lot of AI within our collection space as well. So again, to give you an example, let's say you as a customer, you get your salary on the 5th of every month, okay? And what data says is you have kind of skipped a couple of payments or repayments because the date of repayment that you have chosen at the time of application, loan application, was the 20th of every month. There are some months where you would just obviously miss your repayments because you don't have the money in your account. So we have trained, we have built models which will detect these patterns, which would say that, hey, this customer's salary is credited on the 5th and he runs out of money on the 20th. So why don't we ask for the collection on the 6th? So the model picks it up automatically based on the patterns that it recognizes. It would automatically change, or of course with the consumers, with that customer's approval, it would change the repayment date from the 20th to the 6th of the month. And, you know, and we have already seen the numbers of repayment improving, the number of arrears going down with respect to consumers, right? So that's powerful. Second thing, mechanism of, or the instrument which they use for making a payment. So you as a customer are like, very much interested, or your process has been, you get the salary on the 5th of a month, 80% of the salary is pushed into your, let's say, Paytm wallet or any of your wallet. So what we do is we identify these patterns. The first repayment, the customer did it using his wallet, right? So the subsequent recollection would be, hey, because you have this habit of doing this, we would want to help you make your repayment with just a couple of clicks. So we are not going to even suggest any other kind of an alternate payment instrument, payment channel for making the repayment. We would promote or push the customer in that mode whereby they'll be able to make this repayment, right? So again, what you're seeing over here is the use of AI at its best and the value it is bringing into the organization, right? At the end of the day, result is what is, the data is what is going to tell you whether your model is successful or not. If it is not successful, bring it back, train it again, push it back, give it some time and allow it to mature and you will see the results. But it's about that process which we need to follow. And we, as being a technology company, we put in our AI first process into play.
Great. I mean, you have these use cases for AI models. I mean, you describe them in so detail. But how difficult is it for any fintech startup to implement? I mean, I'm sure you have a specific data science team and AI team, and you're obviously doing some good work. How difficult it is for an average fintech startup to do all of this?
What do you mean by an average fintech startup?
Not average, but like if there is another startup that comes up and who wants to do probably, get in your shoes and, how difficult would that be?
I think it's just the strategy and the mindset.
Okay.
If you're a technology first company, you can't compromise on certain key strategies. If you're an AI first company, or rather you aspire to become an AI first company, then again, there is no other option but for you to have an AI strategy in place before you even start your product building exercise, right? Because it needs to go hand in hand. That's the second thing. Third thing is, if again, just to answer, direct answer to your question is, how do you do it? Bring in some advisors. If you don't have the talent and the experience in-house, bring in some advisors, bring in some consultants. Bring in advisors, I would say, because for those who have done this before, I think, and who have done this before successfully, that's the most important thing. Because whilst you get into the mode of being successfully implementing an AI use case, it would come on the back of several failures. And those lessons are invaluable. So bring in advisor for, let's say, a couple of months so that you can define your AI strategy in a way where you can identify how to identify such use cases, number one. And second thing, it's not about just the tech team doing the work. It is not about just having a data science team. Being an AI first or a technology company, the whole culture of the company should be such where it thinks the technology way, it thinks the AI way. So those things are very important, for which you need to get a lot of buy-in from the company. But if it is a new startup, you don't need to have lot many people taking them or grooming them into getting into that kind of a mindset. So I would say build an AI strategy, bring in a consultant, bring in an advisor who can guide you in such a way so that you don't, reinvent the wheel. You don't fail in the same area which the others would have failed as well, and learn from someone else's mistake, and very rapidly take your first model out there as soon as possible, as early as possible, and get it started. Otherwise, it will never work. We did the same thing, right? We wanted to make sure that we get our first model out there. But before that happened, I made sure that I spent around 4 months' time defining the AI strategy and enabling the team who are like working so close from a product engineering perspective, and also the stakeholders, made sure that they all understand what the AI is and why it is important for the business that we are into. And I think when it comes to fintech, I would say that is, you can't survive or you can't grow if you don't bring in innovation, if you don't bring in AI into your place, right? So these are two very important components for any kind of a startup who are like emerging.
Yeah. And if there's like a data scientist out there or technologist out there, what would that person, like if they're interested in fintech, what would they have to do to join, let's say, ZestMoney, right? What do you look for? Do you also look for domain knowledge for finance? Do you look for, data science skills? What are the things that you're hunting so that you can build up this, as you said, culture and the team?
Okay, so domain knowledge is a nice to have. A must-have skill is being a software engineer. There's a big difference between a developer and being a software engineer. A developer will just get the requirements and sit and code. A software engineer will understand what the problem is, spend a lot of time debugging that problem, coming up with a solution, implementing it, taking it to the next level, taking it to production, making sure that whatever has been released to production is yielding results. If not, refine it further till the time the goals are met, till the time the customers are being impacted in a positive way. they would continue to do it. So there's a big, big difference between a software developer and a software engineer. At ZestMoney, we are looking for software engineers who can think out of the box, who have got great problem-solving skills, who can take ownership. That's a very important piece when it comes to, you know, being part of the ZestMoney family. If you have that hunger to kind of grow, right, I think ZestMoney is a place where you should be definitely working. If you have that hunger to continuously learn and enhance your skills, again, ZestMoney is the place for you to be in. So I think, you know, skills are something which you will develop. I don't look for somebody who is proficient in, let's say, Java, as an example, right? Because writing a code, in a lot of information already exists out there. If you just Google, you will get all those information on how to write a syntax or code like that. That doesn't matter. How do you design? How do you approach? How do you make sure that the quality of your deliverable, of your code is maintained? So those are certain aspects which, and automation, like I'm like super obsessed with automation, right? How do you automate things in such a way whereby efficiency is achieved? Those are certain things. And the last part which I would always look for is operational efficiency. In this world of cloud computing, developers, they get carried away thinking that resources, computing resources, that is unlimited. That is not true. It is unlimited for most of the companies. But then a piece of code, how it is written, okay, determines your operational efficiency of the code that you write. So for me, not banking a lot on the resources or assuming that is unlimited resources exist out there, that's a very wrong way of software engineering or wrong approach to software engineering. I think it's all about writing the code in the most optimal way so that it can get maximum performance is a very important piece which I look for when it comes to interviewing software engineers within ZestMoney. And of course, anybody who is skilled with algorithms, who are like a genius with math, of course, those are the set of people who I would love to hire.
Great. You said you're obsessed with automation. So what are you looking to automate and what more can be automated? What is the work that you're doing there?
So automation has to happen at an organization level, right? It is not just, let's say, automating what the developers, the code that the developers are writing. So there are multiple areas of automation that we have achieved. One is in order to make sure that any piece of code that gets written that can be pushed onto production as early as possible, as soon as possible, we make sure that we have an automated test suite which runs every time any code is changed in the system, right? So that's a hygiene automation which this is part of the software engineer to software developer which I was talking about, right? The software engineer needs to make sure that the code needs to be like automatically tested rather than having to test it manually every single time every character or every line of code is changed. So for me, that test suite automation is one very important. Second thing, I spoke about operational efficiency, right? Operational efficiency this time not from an engineering perspective, but from an operation perspective. So within the fintech space, there is a lot of money that gets exchanged or moved, right? So, and there are a lot of third-party entities which you are dependent on, and sometimes those act as the bottleneck for, or it impacts your TAT, turnaround time for our customers. So, because our model is such where the monies are exchanged at the time of point of sale, when a customer, let's say, selects a product on Amazon to purchase, then chooses ZestMoney as a payment option, they confirm and they use ZestMoney as a payment option, they go ahead with the transaction and the transaction is complete. So now what needs to happen is money from the lender needs to move over to ZestMoney. Money from ZestMoney needs to then move over to the merchant. Then the customer will at one point of time make a repayment which will then move over to ZestMoney. ZestMoney needs to move this money back to the lender at that point of time. So there is too many exchange of monies which is happening. And one very traditional way of doing it is doing it manually, where you do this reconciliation at the end of the day, where somebody is sitting with an Excel sheet, pulling the data from multiple systems, populating it, giving it a structure, running some macros on it, making sure that it is all validated and verified. Sending this or uploading this Excel or maybe converting this Excel into a CSV or into a format which is accepted by the lenders or the merchants, uploading it using SFTP for their system to then pick it up, read it from there. It can happen, it will work, it works. But at the end of the day, how much of time goes off in just doing this whole process, right? So if you have to achieve automation, see, in India, there's a lot of challenges in terms of how banks work, how monies can, again, from a regulatory perspective, you need to have an escrow account, you need to have a nodal account, and which means there are certain rules and regulation of how and when money can be transferred, what is the limit to this transaction, and who is doing it, who is authorized to do it, and everything has to be audited. So if you're bringing in a lot of manual work or manual effort, one, it is prone to errors at some point of time, which every company has to kind of go through that process. How much of a process or checks you try to keep, how many of a gatekeepers that you'd try to keep for any such process, it is going to act as a hindrance for an overall experience for the consumers, and somewhere down the line it is going to hit you. Right? The only option to this is automation. Right? So this whole reconciliation of money is an area which kind of needs to be automated, number one. Collections, right? It's about sending reminder to the customers, making sure that they are making a payment. And because we provide credit to the customers, the whole process of improving the credit score or changing the credit scores, let's say when a repayment is done, again, it used to happen manually where somebody would need to make a check on, you know, what is happening. So that area needs to be automated, because then the customer would say, again, look at the customer experience. Okay, fantastic. I made a repayment today of 1,000 rupees. My credit score, because of my good repayment behavior, it is now increased by 10,000, which is now I can go and make another purchase if I want, right? So it adds a lot of value to them. Another place where it would really help the customers when it comes to automation would be in the form of, be it collections, I would say, which again, I think I've already explained that situation. So look, there are multiple risk decisioning, right? So when we started off the whole process, started off ZestMoney, on day one, our process was like 10% automation, 90% manual. At this point of time, after 4.5 years, 99% is automated, the whole risk decisioning process, 1% is manual. It's very difficult to hit 100% automation when it comes to, let's say, risk decisioning, because there are fraudsters out over there who are more innovative than, you know, the fintech companies. That's the reality of truth, right? We can't do anything about it. So they are going to come up with some ways to kind of trick you.
Can you walk us through one example that you see where a fraudster was extremely innovative? Like, if you have some example, you know, that'll be interesting.
So, see, what happens is, okay, I'll come to that example in a bit. But let me give you an example of where automation will help in from a customer experience perspective. So, as when you go through the loan application journey, you need to upload certain documents, right? And that documents could be, you know, your KYC document, copy of your Aadhaar or whatever it is. Some of them would upload the photograph of their dogs or their cats, okay, instead of uploading their own photograph. Just to trick the system, just let's see what happens, right? Because believe me or not, there are some companies, again, I'm not going to take names out over here, who have got tons and tons of cash lying with them. They just want to give away just using an app. Within 5 minutes, okay, you will be able to, you can get money into your bank account.
Okay.
And again, these are some players who are like luckily shut down now, because they should not be operating that way. There is no KYC process which was being followed. A lot of wrong things that they were doing, right? So
was there like any NBFCs there?
No, they already have the money with them, right? So it was about the platform. So they had an NBFC. So their connection was through another NBFC, which was there for a very long time. So sometimes they kind of lease this NBFC and use the money through them, to route the money through them, because they can't lend without an NBFC. So for that to happen, they do this. Or they have purchased an NBFC license probably several years back and kind of misuse it. RBI have cracked heavily on them, and those NBFCs have been penalized or they have even been shut down, right? So the they have been very stringent now in issuing any license, and it has to go through a lot of checks. We are an NBFC ourselves as well, so we spent close to 3 years, you know, working with them before we got our NBFC license. So we understand the pain, but those have changed in the recent past. Rather than earlier, it used to be quite easy to get an NBFC license. Probably the process were like not that rigorously followed at that point of time. But anyway, so the customers used to upload the photograph of their dogs instead of their own photographs. It then used to go into their manual queue, which means their backlog is going to increase, which means the experience of calling the customer and asking them, hey, what happened? Why have you uploaded a photograph of your dog instead of your own photograph? They'll come up with some weird reason, whatever it is. But then by that time, the intent to purchase is gone for the customer, right? And hence, you know, it's a negative impact on the transaction itself and overall business when it comes to the merchants. So this is where automation of, you know, document recognition. So if a customer is uploading a photo of their cat, AI will automatically come in and say, hey, it's not going to work. Upload your photograph. Or for that matter, because of the kind of phones that we use, sometimes, yeah, most of them are smartphones, but the quality of the camera might not be that great because they might have even a 4K mobile phone, which should have very poor camera quality. And if you don't take the photograph in adequate lighting, then it's going to be all blurry. So again, we'll have to, you know, make sure. So document classification is a great area where AI and automation has come into play, and it has kind of drastically improved the turnaround time for our customers and the user experience, where the feedback loop is almost instantaneous, or it's instantaneous, right? So it's a great use case, again, where you bring in AI and the power of AI. Okay, coming back to the fraud aspect of it, see, innovation, what they do is document forgery happens a lot. Just replacing their address with some bogus address, or inserting a line where your balance of your bank account is set to quite high number, that also happens a lot, right? So we have mechanisms to capture this document, this forgery. And because the identity theft is so common in India, we need to make sure that you can't punish the wrong, right person or the good customer because of a document theft, right? Or an identity theft, sorry. So we need to make sure that we call the person, whoever it is, to see, make sure that we ask them the question. Like it goes through a manual queue, right? It goes through a question, we ask them the question on, have you uploaded this document? They'll say, yes. I see that your balance of your bank account is 2 lakhs now. And they would say, if they have forged the document, they are going to either disconnect the phone,
yeah,
or they kind of spin up another story for that. But it's very clearly says that we have got our automation in such a way where it would get all this information from the bank statement, it would do the compute rather than just looking at the balance at the bottom of the page. Because it also going to pick up ki where is it the debit has happened, where has been the credit happened on the bank account. And it does a bit of a computing over there, does the basic math to see, does it all add up to get the final digit. So document forgery is something which they do, and they have come up with some innovative ways of, so one of the customer had, you know, so they did something with the eyeball. Right, because the color of the eye or something is very important when it comes to certain recognition, because AI will, there are several parameters and data points which it would detect whether a customer who is claiming to be them. So you have a KYC document, let's say an Aadhaar, and then we ask them to take a selfie of there as well to, you know, for likeliness. Sometimes what they do is they change one of the eye if it is for some other person. Right, somebody, let's say of their brother or somebody, they would change the eye color, the eyeball color of the other person as well on the document.
Oh.
Now, the system will pick it up very cleanly, because any document that has been tampered with leaves a kind of a signature depending upon the format of your image or the format of the document. or the type of the document. If it is a JPEG, it is a GIF, it's a PDF. It picks it up very cleanly, and there is algorithms which can detect those anomalies in these documents. So again, when it comes to being creative, they try 100 things. And you may never know, quite a few of them have gone through the system of being so innovative that we didn't even detect it. But what I'm saying is, we have left that 1% in our automation still as a manual process, because as we understand more such innovative, fraudulent ways that we are picking up from other patterns that emerges from our data, we would automate that aspect and push it so that when it happens the next time, automatically the system is going to pick up. So 100% automation is impossible, but we are getting closer to 100, if not 100 at any point of time.
Great. And you mentioned the payment part of it. So I wanted to ask, like, what is ZestMoney's strategy? Is it more focused on lending versus payments? Like, what are the differentiators there?
So we are not a payment gateway.
Yeah.
We are a payment method.
Okay.
Right? That's a big difference over there.
Yeah.
When you, again, at the time of a checkout on, let's say, Flipkart or Amazon or Myntra, Make My Trip, wherever, you should see a cardless EMI as an option of the mode of payments. ZestMoney will be there.
Okay.
Right. So it wouldn't, and if you talk about payment gateways, you have PayU, you have JustPay. Yes. Very different.
PayU, but PayU is also like getting into the space, obviously, you know, the digital lending, consumer lending.
Everyone would want to get into this space, be it even Amazon or Flipkart.
Yes.
They will all get into the space. They have tried it several times and have failed several times. Look, again, it's very easy to give money, very difficult to collect it, because as ZestMoney, we are a platform which does end-to-end loan origination and loan servicing. We have data, and the quality of data is such where our credit, our scoring is much better than that of the bureau scoring when it comes to the accuracy of it, right? To make money, you lose money. We have lost money earlier, but it was, that's the only way you can collect data, right? But then we have emerged, we have evolved over the period of time with, thanks to this data, that the quality of decisions that we make, the accuracy of our decisions that we make, is second to none, I would say. Because these are new customers, new to credit customers. And look at it this way, right? We serve the top 60 million customers as well. They are our customers as well. But we are talking about getting in the 50th million and the 300th or 200th million into the mainstream tag, which is going to open up them getting credit at will and getting credit card at will for the future, right? So we are talking about that untapped area of the Indian population which has never been served. So there is a bit of a risk involved. There is a big risk involved over there. But again, because of the way we have gone about bringing in the use of technology and all our decision making, we have been in a position where our NPAs are quite low compared to the unsecured loans that we are into. And I think we have done brilliantly well on that aspect.
Okay, great. You know, thank you so much for coming here, you know, sharing your stories. Those are some, you know, great insights, and we appreciate you coming here. And on behalf of Analytics India Magazine, we wish you all the very, very best for the future.
Pleasure.
Thank you.
Pleasure. Thank you. So, oof.